Over in Turkey, Kurdish armed group PKK claims responsibility for Sunday's suicide bombing in Ankara. Both attackers died in what the PKK called a sacrificial action against Turkey's interior ministry. This report.
Cell phone video captures the moment assailants detonate a bomb at a security checkpoint near Turkey's interior affairs ministry in the capital city, Ankara. The Interior Ministry's office labeled the blast as a terrorist attack that happened just hours before Parliament was to reconvene.
One of the terrorists who had a suicide bomb contraption blew himself up. The other was shot in the head and neutralized before he found a chance to blow himself up.
The Interior Minister added that he intends to visit two officers injured in the attack, saying neither was in critical condition. Hours after the blast, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan arrived to address Parliament. He praised the swift action by law enforcement for stopping the attackers.
The action in which two murderers were neutralized is the last stand of terrorism. The scoundrels who targeted the peace and security of the citizens could not achieve their goals. They will never reach them.
A senior Turkish official tells the Reuters news agency the attackers hijacked a vehicle, killing its driver about 260 kilometers southeast of the capital. The bombing was the first in Ankara since 2016. Then, groups such as Islamic State and PKK militants, both labeled as terrorist organizations by the U.S., either claimed or were blamed for attacks on major cities. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
At least 13 people killed after a fire broke out in a nightclub in Murcia, Spain. Search efforts continue for those still unaccounted for. The cause of the blaze is still unknown. This is the deadliest nightclub fire in Spain in 33 years. Following a blaze in 1990 at a nightclub in northeastern Zaragoza that left 43 dead. Murcia's mayor has declared 3 days of mourning for the victims. Overseas, another week of turmoil seems to be in the making in Capitol Hill. Hardline Republicans are now looking to oust House Speaker Kevin McCarthy for working with Democrats to avoid a partial government shutdown. Here's the full story.
The bill is passed.
The short-term funding bill that Congress passed Saturday and was signed by President Joe Biden will keep the U.S. government running until at least mid-November. But Biden warned Sunday against a repeat of the chaotic process that preceded the 11th-hour adoption of the stopgap bill.
The brinkmanship has to end, and there shouldn't be another crisis. There's no excuse for another crisis. Consequently, I strongly urge my Republican friends in Congress not to wait. Don't waste time as you did all summer. Pass a year-long budget agreement. Honor the deal we made a few months ago.
But a new showdown might be on the horizon on Capitol Hill. Far-right conservatives aren't happy that House Speaker Kevin McCarthy reached out to Democrats to pass the temporary funding bill. Ousting him is now a top priority for conservative Republican Representative Matt Gaetz.
In January, to get the speakership, Kevin had to agree to certain guardrails on spending. America's lawmakers take one up or down vote on the funding of the entire government. That is crazy. That is the reason we're $33 trillion in debt. We want to move to single subject spending bills. He made that commitment. He broke it.
McCarthy's response was defiant. He appeared on CBS's Face the Nation.
So be it. Bring it on. Let's get over with it and let's start governing. If he's upset because he tried to push us in a shutdown and I made sure government didn't shut down, then let's have that fight.
Regardless of how that plays out, bipartisan compromises will continue to provide a path forward, said Rachel Snyderman with the Bipartisan Policy Center.
There is bipartisan compromise to support additional funding for Ukraine, to support our troops, and ensure that our border security is well funded. And so I think that we're going to see, you know, action on those particular priorities in the coming weeks.
Ukraine and the rest of the world will be watching closely, pointed out political scientist Oscar Pocasangre.
I think longer term, we do need to focus more on a structural reform to institutions and find ways of having more political parties in Congress that would help us reach more consensus in the legislative body, as opposed to just having back and forth between these two very polarized parties.
Pocasangre noted as well that more political instability could hurt the United States' credibility as well as its economic standing. Veronica Valderas Iglesias, VOA News, Washington.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, your news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. With COVID cases on the rise again in British Columbia, its government is bringing back mask mandates in healthcare settings starting this October. Fall and the cold weather usually signal the start of the flu season and more cases of respiratory illnesses in the province. But the BC Center for Disease Control has also noted a steady increase in COVID cases. In its latest report, the BCCDC reported that hospital admissions due to COVID increased to 178 for the week of September 10 to 16, up from the previous week's 161, while new infections for the same period have also increased from 425 to 628. That is why BC's Ministry of Health is bringing back the mask requirement in long-term care facilities and hospitals starting this October.
Para sa akin, it's an advantage and beneficial din, lalo na sa mga healthcare workers kagaya ko, both sa patient or sa resident at sa care staff.
Isa po siyang safety net or additional safeguard, both para sa mga residente or sa patient, as well as sa healthcare workers.
Let's go to Southern California, where young community leaders are stepping up to combat Asian hate.
Violence that is invisible.
Young PhilAm activists are taking steps to raise more awareness when it comes to Asian hate by listening to the stories of victims, like the Roque family, who were physically and racially attacked at a fast food parking lot last May 2022, as well as Nikki Arriola and wife Julian Ongchekno, who were assaulted in Sacramento last February.
The reason why we are involved is that we see our families in Kuya Nikki, Ate Julian, and the Roque family. We see our lolos, we see our lolas, we see our neighbors. We see how little support, Kuya Nikki talked about a lot, how little support there is from people who are supposed to be helping us.
We're gonna be spending most of our time here really getting engaging in dialogue together with our incredible group of panelists who are themselves leaders, organizers, champions, and community pillars together.
And finally, we head to Virginia, where a jazz concert was held to benefit kids battling cancer in the Philippines.
October is Cancer Awareness Month, and to draw attention to the Big C and its impact on children, a jazz concert was held in Virginia, headlined by PhilAm musician Mads Johnson. Proceeds from the event will benefit organizations taking care of children with cancer in the Philippines, such as Child House in Quezon City and Manila, House of Hope in Davao, and Everlasting Hope in Cebu.
I did this thing because my family is impacted by cancer. So my biological father has a stage 4 lung cancer, and my sister-in-law also have breast cancer. And my mother-in-law, she's been suffering it for 20 years, and she have pancreatic cancer.
Blessed to have the talent that we have as being a musician, being an artist, being a singer, songwriter, and whatever. But the thing is, God, this is God's gift to you. You have to give it back.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.